Hey everyone, and welcome to this presentation on the Thalassophobia mode of Horizon Forbidden West. I'll start by talking a little bit about myself. So my name is Joshua, I'm the QA lead here at Guerrilla Games. And I worked on Horizon Forbidden West and the Burning Shores expansion pack, as well as several other Guerrilla titles. And about the QA team, so the QA team exists as an embedded team inside the studio. So we're on site and we work directly with the development team. And as for accessibility, that exists as a shared responsibility inside our studio. So the QA team and also all the other dev teams collaborate together, and collectively we try to push this feature forward a little bit. So about Thalassophobia, I will be talking about three main topics today. First, I'll be talking about why we made a Thalassophobia option, then about how we implemented the Thalassophobia option, and lastly I'll be talking a little bit about the results. So why did we make this option? It started with a fan letter, and I'll read the letter to you. The letter read that Horizon Zero Dawn was and is one of my favorite titles. However, in the new trailer for Forbidden West, you have implied underwater exploration that will be of significant importance. I have severe thalassophobia, making such an activity incredibly stressful for me. For instance, at the end of The Witcher 3, there is a part where you need to dive underwater. I stood on shore for 30 minutes before I could make myself dive, in empty water, for less than 60 seconds. I panic so badly when I need to dive in games that my vision can go black. Could you please make these sections skippable? Otherwise, I will not be able to play the game. I know it's asking a lot, but since thalassophobia is the fourth most common phobia after nyctophobia, arachnophobia, and fear of snakes, perhaps it is a good idea not to potentially make thousands of fans upset. So that was the letter. And it resonated a lot with personal experiences in our team. As it turned out, even some members here at Guerrilla Games have some sort of thalassophobia. So, what did we do? First of all, we had QA start an investigation. Because we weren't immediately able to jump on this request, we understood the individual need, but we were also a little nervous. The idea of redoing one of our very prominent game progression systems was also very scary to us. And we didn't want to make any assumptions on general thalassophobia, as these numbers might not reflect our specific situation. And because swimming was part of our game progression, we needed to know just how much impact stories like these have on our title. So we started a QA investigation. And we did that to identify just how many people would have difficulty swimming in our game. As between GG and our outsourcing partners, we believe that we already had a decent sample size. So just how many people experience difficulties with the swimming sections in our title? We needed to build a business case. So as part of this investigation with QA, we found out that one person in our team had severe thalassophobia, and this person ended up being a very important contributor to making sure that the feature was working properly and that it provided some sort of relief. This feedback loop was super important. We needed someone that experienced these emotions and that could give us an idea of which areas affected them the most, and also if we were making the right decisions. So after our investigation within the QA team was complete, we knew that thalassophobia was at least worth investigating. And we got to work on identifying what the main difficulties were that we had to solve. And we started by first investigating our ideal solution. And through this process, we investigated two design ideas that unfortunately didn't make the cut. At first, we thought that we could introduce a map zones solution. The idea was that we would place an icon alongside the quest marker where we could highlight where the hand-placed safe areas were set up. However, it became kind of difficult to know which marker to bring forward. We weren't always sure if the player wanted to go to a safe space or if they wanted to keep swimming to reach the next mission objective, or maybe they just wanted to get out of a cave. So it was kind of difficult to know where to put the marker. An additional difficulty was the amount of effort it would take to set up all of these zones. So, for example, the designer had to place a zone above the entrance of the tunnel so that the player would be guided towards the entrance of the tunnel when they were near it. But then there would be another zone inside the tunnel to indicate how to make their way through a tunnel and so forth. This would require significant time investment to set up and to maintain throughout development, wherever we made changes to the geometry during development. So as a result, we decided not to go ahead with this idea. Then we had a tracking path solution. The idea was that we could draw a tracking path like an arrow inside the caves for the player to follow. The idea was that this player would, sorry, the arrow would guide the player upwards out of the cave. However, the funny thing is that even our game doesn't always know how to get out of a cave. The game doesn't know if swimming up means that a player will be out of a cave or if the player would just hit a ceiling. So again, we came to the conclusion that it would require manual work to set up. Additionally, we didn't always know which direction the player wants to go and if they already have all of the prerequisites. Does the player have all the items they need to keep following this arrow? Or does the player need to be directed to a quest objective? Does the player even want to proceed with the quest objective, or do they just want to get out of the cave? So again, this proved to be difficult to implement. We decided to take a step back. Only if we have an exact understanding of how to make Thalassophobia more accessible could we scope out this feature. And thanks to Mark Friend, we got information about the main triggers that we could focus on. We picked two main triggers to focus on, hoping that this would alleviate at least most of the issues. But it was difficult to revamp all of the features entirely in our game to reduce the stress factors. So we started thinking, what if we could avoid all of these triggers altogether? We thought that we were already very close to an answer. We have an item in our game that allows for unlimited breathing underwater called the rebreather. And playing with this option would solve our main triggers. What if we could secretly give that item to the player whenever someone toggles the Thalassophobia setting? It seems so easy, but it was a difficult task. The quest design team was the first to hit difficulties. The game expects that only once you have the rebreather that you can go into a specific area. But then this accessibility feature can incorrectly make the game think that whenever the player has passed a moment in the quest where the player gets this rebreather device, when in reality the player is just playing with the setting, so the quest got confused. The UI team also had to implement the setting, of course, and make sure that the setting was properly reflected when the player played the game. And the VFX team gave us an option to make the focus VFX trigger continuously like a radar. This helps to make sure that the player wouldn't be in the dark whenever the player uses the accessibility feature. And lastly, on the QA team, there was a lot of work to make sure that we didn't miss any logic that expected the player to have or to not have the real rebreather. So even though we had the item, it was still quite a lot of work to set all of it up. But we got there in the end, and here are some of the results. So as you can see, there is a radar VFX playing that allows the player to see exactly how far down the chasm goes. Because of this, the water feels a lot less intimidating. And of course, you can breathe underwater forever, which is also very nice to have. Cool. Here's another video. We weren't always able to allow the Thalassophobia option to allow for complete freedom, but we tried wherever we could. And we allowed the player to use the Thalassophobia option for new styles of gameplay when we could. So in this example, you can see the Thalassophobia option turned off on the left and turned on the right. In this section in the Burning Shores, the player has to dodge enemy projectiles coming from a faraway tower. And to dodge these projectiles, the player has to dive underwater. And I decided not to show this in case anyone in the audience has Thalassophobia. But if you stay underwater for too long, you can drown there. But with the setting enabled, you can stay underwater for as long as you like. And we understand that this reduces the challenge of this particular mission. You could theoretically just stay underwater forever and dodge all the projectiles forever. But we believe that giving the players a more comfortable experience is more important than meeting the required difficulty level. So here we decided that it would be allowed to just play with an easier difficulty. So we're happy with the results. There's a couple of things that we would have liked to do better given the opportunity. So if we had more time, what would we have done? The first thing that we would have done is we would have reviewed the min and max brightness of our underwater swimming. We didn't have time to do that because it takes a lot of time to set up proper lighting in all of the environments. But we realized that sometimes it's still pretty dark. This also is like duplicated or made worse because time of day has an impact on the lighting underwater. So if it's dark outside, it's also dark underwater. And sometimes this had pretty significant results. Similarly, when we have a rainstorm, which we often have in our game, it also makes the lighting a lot darker. Then we have machine aggression. So we have a lot of scary machines in our game, and we would have liked to consider to rebalance the aggressiveness with the Thalassophobia mode. We have a few moments in the game where machines can attack the player underwater, and that can be really scary, especially with something like a snap maw, which is a crocodile robot that comes after you. These are pretty intense moments. With more time, we would have set up an alternative version of these encounters. And lastly, we would have removed some underwater effects to indicate that you're swimming in deep water, especially if the water is very murky and visibility is lower. So these are things that we would have liked to have done, but we just didn't have time to implement them. And that's it. Thanks for listening to this presentation on the Thalassophobia mode. I hope you enjoyed it.